Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 9722 in the name of Angela Constance on Northern Ireland Troubles, Legacy and Reconciliation Bill, UK legislation. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Angela Constance to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, around 8 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, this is an opportunity for the Parliament to consider a supplementary legislative consent motion on the UK Government's Northern Ireland Troubles, Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. The UK Government first introduced this bill on the 17th of May 2022, saying their proposals were to implement a range of measures that seek to address the legacy of the Northern Ireland Troubles. The bill includes provision to establish a new independent body, the Independent Commission for Reconciliation and Information Recovery. It seeks to limit criminal investigations, legal proceedings, inquests and police complaints, and extends the Prisoner Release Scheme in the Northern Ireland Sentences Act 1998, and provides for experiences to be recorded and preserved, and for events to be studied and memorialised. After consideration of the bill, the Scottish Government concluded that a legislative consent memorandum should be lodged in the Scottish Parliament due to the impact it will have on devolved areas of competence, with the recommendation that consent be refused.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention. She has outlined the principles of this bill, and I was wondering what conversations the government has managed to have with those on the ground in Northern Ireland about their views of this bill and how they think it will affect things on the ground in Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, what I can say to the member is that I am aware that the bill has been opposed by every political party in Northern Ireland, including the DUP and key stakeholders such as Amnesty International, Relatives for Justice and Widows Against Violence and Power, the latter being the largest cross-community victim group in Northern Ireland. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government advised the Scottish Parliament to refuse consent on the 20th of October 2022 on the bill when the first legislative consent memorandum was lodged. The majority of the Criminal Justice Committee voted to support this position when they published their first report on the bill on 10th of January 2023, with two members voting against the Scottish Government's recommendation. Since then, the UK Government has proposed further amendments to the bill, the most recent of which the UK Government only published and provided in full to the Scottish Government on 8th of June. We have considered these new amendments, and it is still the position of the Scottish Government, which includes the Lord Advocate and the Solicitor General for Scotland, that the recent amendments still do not resolve the concerns that resulted in the recommendation that Parliament should not pass a legislative consent motion in relation to the bill. In the bill's current form, despite the amendments tabled by the UK Government, it still gives rise to three key areas of concern for the Scottish Government that I appraised the Criminal Justice Committee on the 21st of June. These are that, firstly, it will limit the ability of victims of the Troubles to seek justice through Scottish courts if required. Secondly, it does not respect devolution and provides power to the Secretary of State to amend devolved legislation without first discussing with or obtaining consent from this Parliament. And thirdly, it has the potential to impact on the powers of the Lord Advocate as independent head of the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland. The Criminal Justice Committee have now published their final report on the bill on 23rd of June, now with no members voting against the Scottish Government's recommendation to withhold consent. In its current form, the bill still allows the granting of immunity to people who apply for it, even though they may have committed serious offences during the Troubles. Effectively, this bill could mean an amnesty for those who have committed offences such as murder and crimes involving abuse and torture, including where those crimes were conducted by agents of the state. For those who have been directly affected by the Troubles and are seeking justice, these amendments will not increase the opportunity for them to obtain justice or ensure that those who committed offences during the Troubles are appropriately held to account. In its current form, the Bill also provides the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland with the ability to amend devolved legislation without having to make the Scottish Government aware of this, let alone to seek the Scottish Parliament's agreement to do so. If the UK Government respects devolution, it should not be exercising powers within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament unless doing so is specifically agreed. Presiding Officer, even with the concessions made by the UK Government, the Bill continues to encroach on the role of the Lord Advocate as the independent head of the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland. The principle that the Lord Advocate takes decisions in their capacity as head of the systems of prosecution and investigations of deaths independently of any other body predates devolution and is protected by Section 48(5) of the Scotland Act 1998. The power to grant immunity proposed for the Independent Commission created by the UK Government's Bill therefore potentially undermines this principle by adversely impacting on the Lord Advocate's ability to take decisions on whether to commence prosecutions. As I laid out to the Justice Committee last week and previous iterations of the Bill, it was the case that even where immunity was not granted, the Lord Advocate wouldn't be able to commence a prosecution unless and until the Commission decided to formally refer the cases to the Lord Advocate's office. I therefore welcome the amendment proposed by the UK Government, which means that the Lord Advocate can now direct the Commission to refer such a case to the Lord Advocate's office when it is considered appropriate, and I understand the Solicitor General met with Lord Keane to discuss that amendment. However, as I have already stated to the Justice Committee, at the heart of the Bill is the power given to the Commission to grant immunity from prosecution for the most serious of offences. That power to make decisions on whether an individual should be prosecuted is something which in Scotland we would expect to be exercised by the Lord Advocate acting independently in the public interest. Despite the recent amendments to the Bill, the Commission's power to grant immunity does still have the potential to cut across the independent decision-making of the Lord Advocate. In effect, it will be the Commission who have the discretion to decide whether a prosecution can be raised and not the Lord Advocate. The Scottish Government does not think it is wise or appropriate for the UK Government to alter the Lord Advocate's constitutional position in this way, and it is not something which this Parliament, in my view, should consent to. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has a responsibility to review UK Government legislation that will impact on the devolved powers of this Parliament and review any amendments made. We have done so, and it is our recommendation that Parliament maintains its position to withhold legislative consent to the amended Northern Ireland's Troubles, Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. Therefore, I urge all members to support this position that is backed by the Scottish Parliament Justice Committee.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, if you could move the motion for me.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Russell Finlay. Around 6 minutes, Mr Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I grew up with the Troubles on my TV screen. For families in Northern Ireland, it was their lives. Now, today, I think it can be easy for us to forget the daily backdrop of terror and of devastation and death. And I commend the recent five-part BBC documentary, Once Upon a Time, which expertly tells the stories of some of those who suffered, but also some of those who inflicted the suffering. This series is a timely reminder that for many individuals and families, memories remain fresh and losses remain raw. The legislative consent motion before us today relates to an independent commission for reconciliation and information recovery, which would investigate deaths and serious injuries relating to the Troubles. Now, individuals involved in the Troubles can come forward and be provided immunity under certain strictly defined conditions if they provide information relating to an event that took place leading to death or serious injury. These could be about identifying the location of remains of those who were taken away to be tortured and executed by terrorists, or, for example, for anyone who might be harbouring knowledge about one of the many bomb plots that claimed the lives of civilians or military personnel.
Edward May.
Yes, I will.
I thank the member for giving way. I think we all need to be very careful how we talk about this and consider this, but I want to make the following point. On the 20th of July 1982, four soldiers from my regiment riding horses down the South Carriageway at Hyde Park were blown up by a man who planted a bomb, surrounding it by nails, in a car next to their route. Mr. Downey was accused and found guilty of that, but has never been brought to justice because he has a way of avoiding it. In the same time, just 2 years ago, one of my colleagues was charged in Northern Ireland for murder, Dennis Hutchins, who in 1974 shot somebody, and the argument of whether that is correct or not is neither here nor there. But he was dragged to Northern Ireland, where he was prosecuted and subsequently died during the trial. My question to the member is, and my question also that I'd like the government to reflect on, will the Commission bring peace to those people who are left behind? Because we need to do that.
Mr. Finlay, I can give you the time.
Thank you. Thank Edward Mountain for his intervention. I know that as a former soldier, he knows more than most the extent of the troubles and the horrors that they involved. And I do think that is indeed the sentiment behind this legislation. It's about truth, it's about reconciliation, and it's about closure for families who remain very badly affected, and is indeed modelled on the truth and reconciliation approach that's worked very successfully in post-apartheid South Africa, albeit under different circumstances. So this is a sensible bill with a legitimate aim and, crucially, with a consistent approach across the United Kingdom. That's why I find it concerning that the SNP government is seeking to essentially interfere in an issue which is primarily, if not exclusively, affecting Northern Ireland. There would be an outcry from the SNP if Stormont, for example, decided to consent to a bill here and denied consent to a bill produced here in Holyrood, which was about Scotland. Northern Ireland's history is unique. It should not be used for political purposes. It should certainly not be exploited to create any kind of constitutional grievance. I will.
Keith Brown.
So Finlay, for taking intervention, I don't know if you heard what the Cabinet Secretary said, but the parties, all the parties in Northern Ireland, believe this undermines the rights of victims to seek redress. It undermines devolution, and crucially, for the first time I can remember, it undermines the independent role of a Lord Advocate. Does none of that concern him?
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. There are many views about this legislation in Northern Ireland and across the United Kingdom, but I think it's vitally important that a UK-wide approach is taken. Thousands of lives were lost during the Troubles. Thousands more were damaged through the crushing impact of the violence. And everybody wants to move on from that time. Northern Ireland today is nothing like Northern Ireland of the 1970s, the 1980s or the 1990s. Quite why we would want to get involved in what is really an internal issue for the people of Northern Ireland is beyond me. And it would be wrong if this was simply another chance to pick a fight with the UK government. This bill would play an important role in helping Northern Ireland to further consign the violence of the past into the history books. And the UK government has addressed some of the concerns raised by the Lord Advocate, and it's clear that there's willing to continue to address outstanding concerns. When I questioned the Cabinet Secretary about some of the concerns, it transpired there are no live Troubles-related police investigations in Scotland. There do not appear to be any Troubles-related prisoners in Scotland. It is therefore a largely theoretical question. There appears to be a slim chance of the Commission's work impinging on Scotland. But while there remains any chance, I believe that we should support this bill and today vote against the Scottish Government's LCM. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I now call Polly McNeill. Around 5 minutes, Ms. McNeill.
The Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill proposes an effective amnesty from prosecution for Troubles-related offences in exchange for cooperation with the Truth Retrieval Body, and the bill would also halt future civil cases at inquests linked to killings during the conflict. Establishing a new independent commission for reconciliation and information recovery responsible for reviewing deaths and other harmful conduct forming part of the Troubles for publishing its findings. The bill would seemingly effectively draw a line under offences in the Troubles area across the UK by ensuring that long-running cases which have not been resolved are closed and closing avenues for justice in cases which did not involve death or serious injury. However, importantly, this is not the view shared by virtually all of the political parties and victims groups across the island of Ireland, as Keith Brown formerly said, and North and South have slammed the substance of the bill. The Democratic Unionist Party is against it. In fact, one of the few issues that all sides of the political debate in Northern Ireland seem to agree on is that this proposal should not proceed. I do agree with Edward Mountain that there are great sensitivities, and for the people of Northern Ireland, about their history, but it's for that reason we must recognise that it does not have consent of the people. On top of strong opposition in the North, the Republic of Ireland government is also against the bill. And in a press release, Irish Foreign and Defence Minister Michael Martin urged that the bill be paused because it would potentially set back peace in Northern Ireland. The families of victims of the Troubles have also expressed deep concerns about this bill, and some have said it is designed to cause pain and hurt to families seeking the truth about what happened to their loved ones. The Council of Europe has warned that the bill will diminish rights and accountability in a country which has seen precious little. And the Council of Europe Commissioner for Human Rights, Dunja Mijatović, stated that she has repeatedly warned Westminster that the bill would undermine the human rights of victims as well as truth-seeking reconciliation and justice efforts. Because of such opposition, I also worry deeply that the bill opposed by all political parties in Northern Ireland and by victims and survivors of the Troubles across nationalist and unionist committees will be a setback for Northern Ireland. The bill threatens to undermine, or did until I heard the Cabinet Secretary say that there has been a last-minute change to the powers of the Lord Advocate. So that is to be welcomed, although I would prefer to see that a bit earlier, because the committee has scrutinised this over a large number of weeks and had made the same point that a major objection to this is the powers of the Lord Advocate being removed. I had the privilege of representing Scottish Labour on the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly, which includes parties from across all these political parties. And this year, the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly marked the 25 years since the Good Friday Agreement, which largely ended the bloodshed that left 3,600 people dead. I had the privilege of listening to Bertie Ahern, former Taoiseach, Senator George Mitchell, and former civil servants who spoke of the incredible coming together of these people to ensure the Good Friday Agreement. And I'll take an intervention from Paul O'Kane.
Paul O'Kane.
I'm very grateful to Paula McNeill for giving way, and she knows my deep personal interest in this issue. And indeed, she will know that I had the great honour of hosting three people deeply involved in the architecture of the Good Friday Agreement in this Parliament as we marked 25 years of the agreement. They were very clear, as we've heard already in the debate today, that this bill will not work in terms of trying to seek the consensus on reconciliation that is required. It doesn't have the support of the people of Northern Ireland. And I think, crucially, it's relevant to people here in Scotland because of the strong diasporic links between Scotland and Northern Ireland. Would she agree with me that we do have to respect the people of Northern Ireland in this?
Pauline McNeill, I'll give you the time back.
I wholeheartedly agree with Paul O'Kane that while the substance before us is whether or not we would give legislative consent because it cuts across devolved powers, that I do think it's important to take the view that it also does not have the political support of organisations and parties in Northern Ireland. And Britain's exit from the European Union has further complicated the peace process, creating political tensions that have rattled the foundations of the Good Friday Agreement. And as of today, Northern Ireland has been without a sitting assembly for nearly 1 year and a half. If passed, the bill only threatens to further drive a wedge between all political parties in Northern Ireland. And I, for one, think we have a duty as MSPs of a devolved parliament to collectively oppose anything that threatens the Northern Ireland peace process. As I said earlier, I do welcome the late change in the bill in relation to the Lord Advocate's powers. However, in principle, I think the proposals do not have the consent of the community. And I think for those reasons, we absolutely will support the government on the LCM and not ask the Parliament not to recommend the support for the legislative consent motion this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up the debate. Around 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Signing off, so the government does indeed recognise the great sensitivity of the matters that we are discussing today and have proceeded on that basis at all times. In essence, Presiding Officer, the proposed amendments from the UK Government have not gone far enough to remedy the issues that were raised by the Scottish Government and its committees when it was initially recommended in October of 2022 that the Scottish Parliament should not pass a legislative consent motion in relation to this bill. The amendments tabled by the UK Government on the 8th of June, although welcome, do not alleviate the three major concerns we have about this bill. The Scottish Government cannot support a bill that reduces or eliminates the ability of victims of crime to seek justice through our court system. And this position is backed by the Scottish Parliament's Justice Committee. Let us not forget that this bill will provide the Commission the power to grant immunity from prosecution for some of the most serious offences, including abuse, torture and murder. The decision on whether to prosecute someone for these offences should remain with the Lord Advocate, and to remove the decision-making process from that office and place it with another body, in our view, has the potential to adversely impact the long-standing position of the Lord Advocate. Presiding Officer, this bill... No, I won't, Mr. Mountain. If... Yes, OK, I will.
Edward May.
I'm very grateful. There are some people who've already been prosecuted who've got letters from previous UK government called On the Run letters, which allows them to avoid prosecution. So the existence already happens. Do you think that's right? And by doing what you're doing, by preventing this going forward, it will aid resolving the problems that those letters have produced?
Cabinet Secretary.
Mr. Mountain, I'm trying very hard not to have a politicised debate about this, given the matters that we are discussing, and I am aware of the sensitivity for many members across the political divide on this. But I do have a duty as a member of this Parliament to point out issues in terms of access to justice for people who reside in Scotland who may wish to pursue civil or criminal action in Scotland. I do have a duty to stand up to any legislation, irrespective of the purpose of that legislation, if it interferes with the long-standing constitutional right of the Lord Advocate. I will, of course, go on to reflect some of the most sensitive matters and the what we understand in terms of the views around the political groups and also the community groups of interest in Northern Ireland as well. Presiding Officer, the decision on whether to prosecute someone for these offences, in our view, should always remain with the Lord Advocate, and to remove the decision-making process from that office and place it with another body, in our view, has the potential to adversely impact the long-standing position of the Lord Advocate. And it is also our view, Presiding Officer, that the bill will not make it easier for victims who have suffered, as I said, during the Troubles to obtain justice. It is, of course, not only the Scottish Government which has serious concerns over this bill. This has been reflected upon this afternoon, and that there has been widespread opposition to this bill. As I said earlier to Maggie Chapman, all political parties in Northern Ireland oppose the bill, as do key stakeholders, as previously mentioned, such as Amnesty International. Many victims' groups have raised serious concerns on the bill and its ability to help deliver justice and, crucially, reconciliation, including the Widows Against Violence and Power Trauma Centre, which is the largest cross-community victims group in Northern Ireland. Amnesty International conducted polling to gauge opinion about this bill and released the results that showed that 87% of UK adults should still be prosecuted for serious crimes such as murder, even if this was committed decades ago. Graeme Teggart, Amnesty International's UK Northern Ireland Deputy Director, has said that the UK Government's plans for this bill are, and I quote, an affront to decency, human rights and the rule of law and must be scrapped. In addition, Mark Thompson, the Chief Executive Officer of the Belfast-based Relatives for Justice, has said that this bill is, and again I quote, anti-rule of law, anti-victim, anti-Good Friday Agreement, anti-international human rights law, and he goes further to say that, and again I quote, it denies the right, the basic right to an investigation and truth and accountability. And we've also heard that the DUP have also strongly opposed the introduction of this bill, with Sir Geoffrey Donaldson writing to the Prime Minister urging him to scrap the bill. And he also said that reconciliation will not be achieved by sacrifice and justice. Access to justice must be preserved. Michael Martin, the Minister for Foreign Affairs and the Minister for Defence in the Irish Government, has also said that he is deeply worried that the enactment of this bill, opposed by all political parties in Northern Ireland and by victims and survivors of the Troubles across communities, will set back the essential work of reconciliation. Presiding Officer, whilst I note the opposition to this bill, as a government minister, it is for the reasons that I've already outlined that I urge all members of this Parliament to support the Scottish Government's recommendation that the Scottish Parliament do not pass a legislative consent motion in relation to the UK Government's Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate on the Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill UK legislation. It's now time to move on to the next item of business.